you know, Taiwan, mm-hmm. like you go to the night market, mm-hmm. you go to the all the government-owned mm-hmm. building. Mm-hmm. I have to take a glass cup. I have to put my ID card there, yeah. just to...
Even for bubble tea.
Yes.
Good local time, everyone. I'm Audrey Tang, and welcome to Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. Today, we're going to listen from author Huang, who's trying to take everyone's trash and innovate to do something better with it. Good local time, everyone. I'm Audrey Tang, and welcome to Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. Social innovation can come in all shapes and sizes, whether it be a shoe or a skyscraper, online or in a trash can, person to person or plastic to plaza. As the old saying goes, someone's trash is another one's innovation. Today, we're here with author Huang, who's trying to take everyone's trash and innovate it into something so much better. You see, author is the founder of MINIWIZ, 小智研发, which focuses on upcycling material and sustainable design. So together, we talk trash, tech, and how social innovation can help us create a more sustainable environment. So, hi, Arthur.
Hello. Hi, Audrey. Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, so today we're going to have a trash talk, like literally talking about trash.
Trash talk. Yes, I love that.
Awesome. So, I've watched many of your interviews, and you share this idea that, and I quote, it's in the trash that we trust, because trust equals, I guess, possibility, and trash brings this kind of possibility. Is this something that you have said, or am I paraphrasing you?
Paraphrasing is definitely certainly much more condensed than how I normally would put it. But I think trash is so important mm-hmm. is because if we want to be sustainable, we must mm-hmm. be like nature.
Ah.
So to be like nature, it produces zero waste. It has no trash. So the ultimate goal for any of what we call civilized society is to produce zero trash.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so that's why certainly... Trash mm-hmm. is the new cash, I would say, because that's the only way for us to incentivize ourselves to stop producing trash.
So act naturally because there's no trash in the nature.
Yes, this is exactly.
A fundamental insight. When did that insight occur to you?
Unfortunately, it did not occur to me when I was in Taiwan.
Uh-huh.
That occurred to me when I was studying in Ithaca, New York.
Okay.
And then from Ithaca, New York, you're like, wow, this is major nature, because we grew up in Taiwan's cityscape.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Then once you get to nature, you see how pretty it is.
Yeah.
But then when you get to Rome, you see how man-made and nature are fused together.
Uh-huh.
And then the next thing is we are studying all the beautiful architecture.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next thing you realize, it was actually all made from trash.
Ah, okay.
And then we, like all these urbanites, like urban people, are there trying to study the beauty of these trash buildings.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And back then, it's still lots of Japanese tourists. So they're taking these crazy photos with these crazy cameras, looking at a bunch of...
I know those crazy cameras.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Was looking at a piece of trash.
So it's like a piece of art, public art.
Yeah, but... Uh-huh. But the problem is, it's just actually in reality, the material content is packaging waste from the Roman Empire.
Okay. So the point here I think you're making is that what we're looking is not just trash from some period or trash that is man-made, but rather situated in a way that it fits our kind of habitat in a way that sounds natural. But in Taiwan, when at least when I was raised as a child in Taiwan, we were taught something else. We were taught to reduce, to recycle, and I'm missing something, right? Reduce, recycle, and reuse.
Reuse,
yes. Right, so 资源回收, right, is something that we associate this idea. But what you're saying is something else entirely, and you also like the word upcycling. Yeah. So how does that differ from reduce and reuse and recycle?
Yeah, but reduction is the most important part. Mm-hmm. Actually, you need to shut down the tab. That's the first thing.
Okay.
Unfortunately, we can't shut it down mm-hmm. because right now the linear economy, everything is aligned. Incentives mm-hmm. are aligned. Mm-hmm. So by shutting down the tab, somebody's going to lose jobs. And most of the economy will stop. Okay. So unfortunately, we can't shut down the tab, but you have to try to shut down the tab. So in between, there's this thing called circular economy. I hate that term.
Okay.
But it's actually trying to capture as much of the leftover from that wastage from our current system and try to elongate its life cycle. Okay, so that's kind of, in a way, is reducing the amount of consumption.
Over a longer time.
Yeah. So it just makes something last longer. Uh-huh. So that's what we call reductions. Mm-hmm. And then if you can recycle, when it passes its life cycle, and you run to reuse it again.
Yeah.
So that's the ultimate form of reuse is recycle. But you try not to recycle at all, actually. Mm-hmm. You just don't want to throw anything away. That's the first thing we should be doing. Unfortunately, this is completely against the capitalistic system.
Yeah. But why call it upcycling when everybody else called it recycling?
That's actually very simple. Uh-huh. For example, the trash, after its life cycle, its final usage, it has very low value.
Okay.
So you want to not take that material and go back to the same product. You want to go take that material, take that material to a higher level of products, which higher value.
I see.
So that's upcycling. You're trying to bring up the cycle. Normally, the higher value product lasts longer.
Yeah.
Right? So that's...
Of course. That's why we pay the premium for
Yes, it. That's why you pay the premium for it. That's why it's called upcycling. So we're trying to make that material stay in our system and be useful within that system for as long as possible.
I see. So after we elongated its use, and when we try to recycle it, we see new, like, fashionable uses of it or the new societal needs that it helped address and so on. So at the end of the day, what you're saying is that it adds more value to the society when it's recycled, and therefore we call it upcycling.
Yes, yes. Uh-huh. But I had to go down to, I really don't like the word recycling because that means you have to melt down, you have to create footprints, you actually are creating secondary pollutions. So in this upcycling process, another up is that you do not want to create secondary pollution.
Okay.
To get a single use to a much durable life form, right? So you want to, and one last thing I want to say is it's really sad that we are taking a space age material, which is like plastic, which is like aluminum, titanium, these very expensive material. We are making them into single use.
Yeah.
This is completely...
Like just one shot, and then it goes to
one
a landfill.
Shot, yes, and that's just completely insane.
Okay. So thank you for elaborating this very important idea. So you started MINIWIZ in 2005. What was the mood back then? What was the kind of societal reception to the ideas that you just outlined for us?
Not at all.
Not at all.
Receptive. But I think at that time is this word called sustainability, which are overused.
Yeah.
And green and sustainability was the big word.
Yep.
And so for us, studying engineering and architecture is all about green building, sustainable development. That was the thing.
I know,
and
the certificate for green buildings was all the rage.
All the rage. But then once you start researching what they mean by green, then you get really mad.
Okay.
So I would say all my how we started the company is based on anger management. I was so angry at what I am, my understanding versus these greenwashing rhetorics. And then he's like, "Look, we got to show people what zero waste really means.
Okay.
So that's kind of like, it's when you're young and stupid and then you're like...
turning anger into action.
Yes. And so if you care about something, that will get you quite mad. But if you don't care about that, it's okay. So...
Yeah, but I think more and more people are actually caring about this particular issue. And in the Trash Lab, which you also founded, I'm told that there's over 1,200 different kinds of materials that's upcycled in the Trash Lab. But that's a lot of different varieties. So where did you get those varieties from?
No, so the varieties, actually, think about the stuff you eat, the packaging.
Yeah.
You throw away. Think about every time fashion, the stuff you throw away.
Yeah.
Just think about the automobile, all the material in the automobile after its life cycle. What are the stuff that the used car throw away? All the way to architecture. Building, end of its life, you're also throwing away plenty of things.
Right.
Interior decorations, all the way to concrete.
Yeah.
So all that material, if you think about it, so much varieties. And you just multiply every one of them with three or four different applications of its final destination or a more durable destination, it's already easily 2,000. So we are still far from completing that overall data sheets. But that data sheets are evolving too. You know, as we change our habit, that data sheet change.
Yep. So if we, like, for example, start to upcycle more or reduce even more, that means that some materials naturally do not appear
On the data sheet. Yes,
okay. And that's the ultimate goal. Right?
Yeah, and, so a lot of people find us a very strange business. You're phasing yourself out from day one.
Designing yourself out of business.
Yeah, design yourself out of business. But to us, we say, no, because all this is actually a service. It's actually a solution provider. Solution for the better is trying to provide value through knowledge, through technology. So we use so much AI, we so much robotic just to get the right type of trash, just to be automated. You know, all this very huge amount of variable, but you have to condense it to a process where it's not producing pollution at the same time creating value. This is a way of linking value, creating value from nothing.
I see.
And I think that comparative advantage doesn't matter who we, doesn't matter as internally for people we work with, to external partner we work with. I think people all learn something from this whole process.
Right, so it's almost like pedagogical.
Yes,
like
you're
teaching something and instructing other people to also share this idea with other people. I was personally very inspired a few years ago when I visited Taipei Flora Expo Park and saw this Echo Arc building, which is also something that you did. And of course, it won you wide international recognition. Can you share with us a little bit about the story of how that building came about?
That building is, we used to do a lot of smaller products. And I think the Taipei government at that time and also a Far Eastern company, they actually was thinking something to do something with recycling and involving the public. And so we are talking about ESG today.
Yeah.
So that's kind of one of the earliest ESG.
Precursor, yes.
Yeah, it was one of the earliest ESG project we did with the Taipei citizen. So we come up with a campaign to ask the Taipei citizen to donate 1.5 million PET bottle so we can create a curtain wall system. Curtain wall is external skin of a building. And that actually become a green building. It become using very low footprint to create a material. At the same time, insulate the building, make it very fancy, lights up as a kind of museum for the city. So it was literally... asking people to help us to collect the material. And then we turn that into a value that's lasting value for the city.
When I close my eyes now, I still remember the light. So it's really something special.
It's called light pollution sometimes.
Okay. Yeah, but you literally crowdsourced
the
input from the citizens of Taipei.
Yes.
Was it difficult to convince the mayor or the Far East or whomever that you needed to talk to complete that project?
For that project, from the very top, because I think the Taipei mayor at that time is super environmental himself. Yep. Okay. Also, Far Eastern chairman from the highest level is also super environmental. So I don't really have to convince them. I think actually convincing the manager and different directors from different districts, that was the hard part.
Why is it hard?
For example, like this material has never been used in the architecture setting.
Ah, what if it collapsed?
Yes. What if it collapsed? What if the typhoon comes? What if the safety issues?
Earthquake.
Yeah, and then we have to go through so many external committees. Your structural committees, mechanical committees, fire committees, fire department. And then we have to get building certification. Mm-hmm. And a fun fact is that that building is designed to withstand 15 degree typhoon.
Yeah, sure. Yeah?
Also, on top of that, it has 100年的回归期.
Oh, wow.
Okay. 100年的回归期 means 100 year life cycle.
Yeah, a whole century.
Yeah. Can you imagine expo building require you to do a hospital grade mechanical structural standard?
Well, because, into the 22nd century.
Yeah, because people are afraid that it's trying something new.
Yeah.
It's going to have a lot of risk that associated with that, especially when it's a public building. And so I think, and in between, it's a convincing different constituents, the gatekeeper, let's say, to take a chance. I'm really thankful that Taiwan has that spirit to take the chance with us, you know, and I think, yeah, this type of things, I will always make me almost want to cry because it's throughout the thing, I only have this one word, grateful that people are willing to take a chance. And then it become this kind of collective art that we created together and still here and still being used and still being used as many exhibitions.
So, yeah, truly built to last.
Yes. Yes, still quite lasting, yes.
That's excellent. Let's rewind a little bit and get back to the start of your learning and innovation journey. So when you were 15 years old, seems you joined and won an innovation contest held by Disney. Do you still remember what was the story was all about?
The story was so ridiculous. It's actually, I just went to Michael's. I don't know if you guys know Michael in the States. It's basically a arts and crafts store. By accident, and I just bought a piece of clay.
Okay.
And it was just a piece of wet paper mache on my hand. And then I was in the orchestra. I was a violin player. So while we're waiting for some people to finish practicing certain parts, I was just playing with that piece of clay. And then I made a, look like a bear, looks like a dog.
Okay.
And then my violin teacher, the conductors, saw that, he's like, yeah, you should send that in. And at the end, he just took that thing and sent it to Disney. And that's all there is.
Okay.
And so then that just won a big award for such a tiny thing, literally.
Okay. It sounds like you went with the flow, right? Innovation without intention.
Yeah, it's completely. And then I was always wanted to be a doctor because my uncle is a very famous like surgeon, and then I'm always very interested in science. And so unfortunately, after, this is fortunate and unfortunate, because after this Disney's creative challenge, this innovation challenge, and gave me this award, both on kind of like a visual art, right, in a way. So all of a sudden, you like, maybe I should study something that related more to a creative industry.
I see. And you went on to study architecture?
I went on to study architecture and civil engineering.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. But did you enjoy your architecture and civil engineering
professors? Oh, that was the funnest time of my life.
How so?
Because in architecture, you get to create. And you actually have to create with gravity. You have to defy gravity. You have to defy material constraints. You have to defy programmatic constraint. You have to defy sight. You have to work with people. And this confluence of all these different forces to create something and to make models. Oh, I love making models. I love, and to make models, you have to do a little bit of calculation, but you have to do a lot of these physical work. So I was enjoying learning how to weld, how to do woodwork, how to do 3D printing. Back then, there's no 3D printing, by the way. How to do CNC, how to make epoxy with of carbon fiber. You know, for me, it was it's a funnest time. I still smile every time I think about my college days.
Hundreds and thousands of materials.
Yes. It's so much fun. Yes.
Excellent. And then you started MINIWIZ when you were in New York.
Yes.
And was it difficult to start your first startup?
It's difficult because I think in the States, I was trying to do something physical. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get into something digital because I feel like the sustainability need to be in people's hand. Mm-hmm. That's why initially our model is zero waste, green power in your hand. Because back then it's all conceptual concepts, right? Uh-huh. So we want to get it into people's hand so your lifestyle can really link to a sustainable or circular lifestyle.
Right, so it goes back to this, like being tangible helps you educate people.
Yes, and so we started lots of different products using green material, means recycled material. So when we first doing that, if you type, you want to buy recycled material, okay, you go on internet, you type Google recycled material, you get Alibaba. Then you enter Alibaba, and then you go, oh, there are these suppliers that give you recycled material. Then you go visit them in China. 20 years ago, guess what you see? A container of trash sitting in the rice field.
Okay.
In the field. Container and container of trash. You open the container, it's actually all Western trash.
Oh, wow. Okay. So it's imported.
Imported Western trash. And so for me, that dawns on me. That's a revelation because, wow, there's no such thing as recycled material at the moment. Nobody's using recycled material. And it also give you a epiphany is that the Western culture, they claim they recycle, but they don't.
They export
so-called
recycling.
Yes. And then you start asking a series of questions. Why? Why aren't UK recycling their own trash? Why isn't Japan recycling their trash? Where is Taiwan's trash?
Yeah.
Where is US trash? And then as you start to research, it gets you more and more angry because most trash is actually buried or burned.
Yeah.
So the recycling at that time was fake. And then you realize when I was in Taiwan, when I was in the US, there's always a recycle bin. And then there's...
It's for show.
It's for show. It's literally for show. And then you go behind the scene to figure out what happened. Then you realize the reason is because there's no value for the transformation.
Right.
Nobody needs a... So the material is not sexy. It's not strong. It's not high performance, especially when you have when soil is dirty, when it's people did not clean the food, when paper diapers is mixed into it. You know, all that container is basically worthless. So that became our little moment where, okay, this is something we really need to solve, and maybe we can do that with something that require more material than just a product. Because I was just thinking, wow, this container worth of this material, how many of these little products do I have to sell just to take that material into that material? And then that's when we went back to architecture. And that foray into architecture started before the EcoArch. And EcoArch, right, really was a culmination of that experiment.
Yeah, EcoArch is like your answer to the question you just posed as part of your epiphany.
Yeah, but the strange part is EcoArch is hard to duplicate. We have been spending the last 10 years trying to figure out how to duplicate EcoArch.
And why is it hard to duplicate?
Like I was mentioning, I was super grateful that many of these bottlenecks and these gatekeepers are on the helping side.
There's a strong political will.
Yes. But if you imagine when you're going to different places, go to New York, go to Singapore, go to China, all that status quo is there. And that require a different type of lubricants to to turn on or to reduce the resistance.
Yeah. I see.
And so this is kind of our quest for the last 15 years to try to come up with a business model that allows us to be able to duplicate this transformation process at scale. Mm-hmm. So that's why technology become a key part to that.
I see.
You have to be able to decentralize all the manufacturing. Mm-hmm. So local waste can be transformed as quickly as possible, mm-hmm. as cleanly as possible on site. Mm-hmm. So that forces us to go into software, go into AI, forces us to do mm-hmm. LCA analysis, simulations, and all the way to controlling the smart machines to be able to do that on site.
Mm-hmm. So this decentralization brought you to many places. Before this recording, you were just saying that you've been to like four different countries.
Yes.
Before going back to Taiwan. Welcome back.
Yes, thank you.
Hi. But you're still based in Taiwan, right? Your office. And why is that?
Oh, yeah. This is the easiest question for me to answer. Okay. Like, we have lots of different offices. Mm-hmm. At the end, where we can do the quickest, fastest innovation, both mm-hmm. software and hardware, mm-hmm. is still in Taiwan.
I see. So because rapid iteration.
Rapid iteration uh-huh. and relatively low cost. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And people are very, friendly. Like, lots of these bosses of these different companies mm-hmm, are mm-hmm. actually technicians themselves. Yeah. Uh-huh. So you're not dealing with a business professional. You are dealing with another engineer mm-hmm, mm-hmm. who actually knows his trade very well. Mm-hmm. So I'm actually learning a lot from these older generation professionals mm-hmm. With 30 years of manufacturing experience on their belt in just one machine.
Oh, wow. Uh-huh.
So I'm actually capitalizing their learning and we are repackaging them into a format where mm-hmm. we think it's good for the environment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're what we call the hidden champions of Taiwan. And what you're saying is that you found them this kind of international stage to turn what they have learned into a decentralizing movement across the globe.
Yeah, and actually they are already, I would never call them like hidden champions.
Okay.
The reason is because all their work and products uh-huh. are the product we have every day in our hands.
I see.
Apple's products, uh-huh. Nike products. If mm-hmm. you think about, like, you know, doesn't matter what fashion goods, doesn't matter what consumable mm-hmm. or consumer electronics mm-hmm. you're using, it's a lot of them has to go through the Taiwan R&D. I was actually not so for Taiwan before until I was actually involved. And another thing I have to say is, distance. Mm-hmm. Taiwan is very small.
Yeah.
So the ecosystem is so short. Mm-hmm. One of the problem when we are in China is that if I want to get to one supplier to another supplier, mm-hmm. just the traveling, it actually just the physical time traveling, it's already reduced mm-hmm. your capability to try new things.
I see. And in Taiwan, it's never more than an hour and a half by high-speed rails.
Yes. And normally the suppliers right next to each other. Uh-huh, uh-huh. And so you can just like literally, you can have four factory meetings in one day.
Oh, wow. Okay.
That's rapid iteration. That's the efficiency uh-huh. that I don't think so far I found anywhere else.
Okay. And you said that you were not exactly for Taiwan before you started your startup and sourced from the Taiwanese champions. Let's just call them champions. Yeah. But is it a bit because you're actually raised in Taiwan, but you moved since you're 12?
Yes.
So why did you or your family move and how was the experience?
Moving to the United States, immigrating to the United States was of course, you always have this 憧憬, how do you say 憧憬? It's like you have this yearnings, uh-huh. saying that there's a better and more advanced, more developed world, okay?
The American dream.
Yes, American dream. Uh-huh. But in reality, when you're actually there going through your education, there for Asian Americans, there's a huge amount of, I would say, prejudice or racism or whatever. I don't want to.
Uh-huh.
Definitely.
In stereotyping.
Yeah, stereotyping. Uh-huh. I mean, okay, I hate that immigrant stories uh-huh. too, but it
no,
is.
No, do share it. I don't hate those stories.
Okay. So, for example, when I first was in junior high, mm-hmm. They literally locked me in the locker room.
Oh, wow. And what for?
For fun.
Wow.
Yeah, okay. I'm sure young kids are uh-huh. just. Yeah. Evil and just
mean, to, each
mean
other.
To each other. Uh-huh. There's no problem. I understand uh-huh. that. Uh-huh. But just because you don't speak English, just because you're Asian, just because you seem a little bit, well, in Taiwan we call guai, So they turned you into this. So good thing when I was in Taiwan, I wasn't that guai. You know, I wasn't such a good kid.
Guai as in obedient.
Obedient, yeah. So I already get in a lot of fights. Mm-hmm. So I take the, we call it the Asian fighting style, which is...
Okay, kung fu.
No.
Not really kung fu.
It's a very bad term. But when I was in high school, they called me Viet Cong.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, they call me the crazy Asian dudes.
Okay.
Because they... once you get in a fight in public and then they see how crazy you are, they stop picking on you.
Yeah. So you look obedient, but you're anything but.
Yeah, but I mean, you have to fight for yourself. Uh-huh. Unfortunately, when I was in the States, I realized a lot in California, many of the Asian Americans or any of the immigrants, at the end, they did not fight for themselves. So they end up having their own little community, bunch of Asian people get together and just hang out together. It's a comfort zone.
Yeah, very cozy.
Yeah, but I guess by nature, I just don't want to be in that zone. I want to, when someone doing this, I don't think it's right, I want to fight back. So I think the immigrant story is a good one because it make you grow at the end. So that's also keep you honest to yourself. Rather than having a fake conceptualization of who you are. And this is my criticism for many of my colleagues in Taiwan, especially when they go to good university, because you're in the comfort zone and you're the top students.
That's right.
And you become so comfortable at your intelligence or this general respect that you actually never really... look at yourself in a very honest mirror. And I think this gave me the tenacity and the humbleness to continue to do what we do. I think this is the immigrant story. I think that is the huge value for us.
Yeah, definitely. I've seen many people who have suffered from schools, well, myself included, that forced us to think outside of the box of the system. But you also became a teacher, which is very interesting given what you have experienced in school. What did you teach? Did you teach in Taiwan or the U.S.?
I taught in Taiwan, also taught in the U.S.
Oh, wow.
So I taught architecture and material, material engineering and architecture. So I think that's a very natural way of sharing some of our experience with schools in the Taiwan school system and then also in the U.S. system.
Was there cultural differences between the students of those two places?
For sure. For sure.
How so?
One thing is in Asia, if you say anything, there's no response.
Okay.
But in the States, there's so much response. There's so much questions, but half of them is just, they just want to hear their voice.
I see.
You know what I mean? So it's like, wait, you don't really want to ask the questions. You just want to, you know, sound smart. So I think there's a difference. But in Asia, they don't say anything, but they are actually secretly like researching whether you say it right or not. So they are like... I would say this is a huge difference in cultural. So that's why when you were asking initially, when you start a company in the States, what's the difference and all that stuff?
There's a challenge there.
There's a huge challenge. So for example, when I come back to Asia, these hidden champions, you know, deep inside, they are super feisty. You know, they are like, that's why they keep innovating. They keep coming out with new product for Nike. They keep complaining that Nike don't know how good this product is. You know, they like, you know, and then in reverse, in the US, they talk as if they own the technology. And then this technology.
Yeah, they've got a nice looking brand.
So this is a very huge dichotomy. So it's very much reflected. And I always thought, because of my experience, I hope I can be that bridge between the hidden champion, let's say, of these engineer who doesn't have that luxury of accustomed to different culture, but they do have this deep yearning to succeed in excellence in their craft. And then, and you have to balance that with a lot of the... the branding talks in the West. Yeah. So if you see a circular economy today, if we go back to the topic on circular economy, many of the developed nations has a lot of cultural superiority rhetoric in circular economy. And I find that very misleading. Okay. And but if you look at on the other side, if you look at Taiwan, we are like kind of developed nation, but at the same time, we still don't think like a developed nation. We think like, oh, Holland definitely has better way of dealing with trash.
先进国家, advanced countries, let's catch up to them.
You're like, wait, you have the highest trash burning rate. By the way, Copenhagen recently says, oh, we do heat recycling for trash, means burning trash.
Okay, heat recycling.
But you know, Taiwan has been burning trash to turn into heat recycling for the last 20 years already. And we are the highest density per capita of incineration.
Incinerators,
so if you think incineration is a good a sustainable story, we are way ahead of a curve.
We've been doing that since the turn of century.
But that's not a good thing.
Of course.
But imagine, but when Copenhagen does it, wow, that's such a so advanced. You're like, wait, what's so advanced about that? You are doing that. But you never look at yourself. And some of your, I think this is a learning between the East and West. And then I think there's a lot of cross-cultural pollinations. And I think, for example, the Copenhagen project, what's the most interesting about that project is it turns the fire incineration plant into a ski resort.
Oh, wow.
See, that is
innovative. That's social innovation.
That's social innovation. So you're taking it, but in Taiwan, we only turn our fire incineration into panoramic restaurants.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we do that.
Yeah, but how many people want to dine by the
incinerator? It takes a special taste.
Exactly. So I think this is where two different set of cultural understanding can really learn from each other, and that can really fuel something really interesting. And we definitely hope we are that bridge or be part of that ecosystem between the two.
Did your students on either of those cultures end up working with you in any way?
Yes, many of them. Yeah, actually, in our office, actually, many of my current co-founder, he used to be my student, Jarvis, and now he's actually my teacher.
Oh, wow. In what?
In technology. He's our CTO. We founded the company together. Now he knows everything about productions. He knows way more than me. So you see, this is a... and of course, we also have Western colleague who we collaborate with, and then they see the amount of knowledge, how they can translate that into completely different creative applications. So
to recap very quickly, I think like catching up to the advanced countries thing, now that we're actually a developed nation, we're actually bringing Taiwan to the world and show our own social innovations and just be a little bit more self-confident in our innovation environment.
Yeah.
Are there anything else in our innovation environment that you also see that has rooms to improve?
No, for example, like I think there's a, if you talk about social innovations, I think there is a weird sense of collectiveness, even though there's very chaotic, but Taiwan do have a weird sense of like a collective.
Like a community.
Community goodness.
Spirit. Yes.
Yeah. So you kind of have an idea what good is.
Yes.
I don't think a lot of Western culture has that. They don't have that consensus.
Yeah, the Western people would associate with the kind of Japanese culture, something like that.
Yeah. So we do still have a little bit of that collectiveness. And that, even though with this very free democratic system, we still have that kind of shared aim, which I find that very strange. But good strange, right?
It's a
good strange.
Like it's useful encountering a pandemic, for example.
Yeah.
Where everyone reminds everyone else.
Remind everyone. There's a social reinforcement on what is a proper decorum. But if you go to the West, sometimes I feel like it's way too individualistic, and then to a point of hurting people, you know. And this is
just to make a point.
Just to make a point. Yes, I don't want to wear a mask just to make a point. So you see, this is Pandemic really shows that. Mm-hmm. I think even though we bickers a lot in Taiwan, mm-hmm. just like everywhere else,
yeah.
but we do have that shared mission. A little bit still like still have that Asian mm-hmm. family at the end, you know? You mm-hmm. can fight all day long at the end.
At the end, we're still family.
Yes, so mm-hmm. I feel that this is very different from the a lot of a Western culture I work with, yeah.
Okay.
So well, more like Italian, actually.
Yes, actually, there are similarities.
There's very similar. At the end, like, uh-huh. Italian fight all day, but at the end, like, they stick together.
Yeah, and they call each other uncles and aunts, too,
yeah.
like we do here.
Yeah, so at the end, I remember, because my wife uh-huh. is Italian, so uh-huh. when we have a lot of interaction with Italian culture. Uh-huh. So at the end, it's like, it comes down to every other terms goes back to mom and dad.
Mm.
And then if it's not mom and dad, it goes back down to, oh, we Italian is like this. You know, we're like, okay. You fight all day long, but at the end, you have this kind of weird sense of identity. It's still there. So when people say Taiwan doesn't have identity, I actually doubt that. It actually has more identity than we think.
So the identity is not about a certain religion or a certain ethnicity, or but rather a kind of family spirit.
Yes, I really do think so. Yeah.
Excellent. So, Arthur, you've also turned your attention toward fighting the pandemic. Can you share with us briefly how you made disinfecting more effective with technology?
Okay, so first of all, during the pandemic, all the countries shut down.
Yeah?
So I cannot leave. And also, nothing can come in either. And during the pandemic time, everybody is scavenged for medical devices.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay, and we are in... So when we have an opportunity to work with the Taiwan government
mm-hmm.
And Taiwan Design Center, and also with Furen Dashi, mm-hmm, the mm-hmm. hospitals,
mm-hmm.
We want to build a hospital ward designed for pandemic, but there's no material.
Mm-hmm.
So we came out with this concept, which is what we do all the time. We have mm-hmm. only one concept,
mm-hmm.
turning trash into a hospital mm-hmm. material.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, you want to get to a pandemic level ICU.
Yeah.
You need to have negative pressure. So that's mean the building system needs to be low leakage rate.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to reduce cleaning. You have to do remote care. So you have to link up with all kinds of digital software.
Mm-hmm.
To have that new ICU, that whatever we are designing, whatever we're building, mm-hmm. to be better than before.
And you need to do it fast.
And you have to do it fast,
uh-huh.
and you have to do it with, you cannot import.
That's right.
So that pretty much put, you call this circular method
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
of make,
mm-hmm.
become front and center. So mm-hmm. what we have done in the last 20 years actually culminate very quickly into a hospital war.
Mm-hmm.
We use Taiwan's like waste aluminum,
mm-hmm.
waste polyethylene, mm-hmm. and waste poly PET.
Mm-hmm.
And we turn that, some of it's hospital waste already,
mm-hmm.
and we turn that into all the building material and this wall, ceiling, cabinetries, all the way to the oxygen and suction intake valve, you know? So this is... super, I think it's super interesting. And mm-hmm. what's interesting, not interesting for most people, by mm-hmm. the way, it's very difficult for most people, is you have to pass a lot of certification,
mm-hmm.
performance certification.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Leakage rate, mm-hmm. antibacterial, antiviral, mm-hmm. All the way to durability, and all the way to non-flammability, by mm-hmm. the way, because in the hospital, everything is oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
And another, so imagine you have all these digital systems
mm-hmm.
Trying to remotely care for your patients
mm-hmm.
who is trying to reduce contact, right?
Yeah.
How do you going to design a smart system linking with lots of Taiwan's mm-hmm. supplier on smart cameras, medical devices,
mm-hmm.
electronic papers, and then at the same time to be able to do all the digital control, right? Digital control of power,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
A smart, what we call smart junction box.
Yep. Okay.
So all this kind of like jumbled together, that mm-hmm. turns into the hospital.
And I remember presiding over this award in the Asia Pacific Social Enterprise Summit, and the modular design actually won a lot of points from the judges and so on. So talk a little bit about the idea of modularity.
Okay, so the whole idea when we are presenting to the government, Taiwan government, was that there are lots of unused capacity. So a lot of unused capacity on lots of existing buildings. For example, a school is shut down during pandemic, but that can be a hospital. So can you have a modular Lego block system that you can just go into a school and plug it in?
I see.
And that can turn that into a hospital. And that's exactly what a MacWorld system is.
So you just need room and electricity.
Yes, you need electricity. We even design a second phase. We even design a plumbing.
I didn't know about that.
Okay, the plumbing doesn't require, because during COVID patients, all your feces needs to go to a special pipe and a special cistern. Okay, so we kind of even come up with a way to basically, like an airplane, airplane toilet.
Okay.
Yeah, so you can put an airplane toilet, so the pipe can go sideways, go up, and go back. And so it's no longer restricted by existing conduits of existing buildings. So that means you can build a pandemic toilet in the middle of a school without worrying about contaminations into existing cisterns. So I think these are some of the innovation that happens very quickly in Taiwan. And I think, and I think it's without like these gutsy doctors,
willing to take risks.
They have to take risks too.
Nobody have tried that before.
And then of course we also have to take risks. And fortunately, we don't have to. We can't go anywhere because of a pandemic. So it's lucky for us to focus on a project that's meaningful to our community, and it's also meaningful to the problem at hand, right? The we are solving the problem with trash, and I really love that. Like, you can use trash to save lives. So what else can you not do?
Yeah, medical grade use of trash.
Yes. So what else can you not do?
Exactly.
You know, well, a lot of people is like, oh, can you do this? Can you do this? Look, I can build a hospital. Or can you? It's like, okay.
So nowadays, the necessity of pandemic prevention also create a lot of waste, like antithesis of zero waste, right? Just a mask alone is a lot of waste, and not to mention the rapid test kits, vaccination needles, syringe, list goes on. So are those things part of your thousands of stuff that you're upcycling in the trash lab?
Yes, we recently did a project with Fubon Bank, the biggest banking group in Taiwan.
Yeah?
We collect masks from all the banking retail, and we turn the mask into wireless charger. And using mask and directly with the robot in front of everyone. So people can learn how simple circular technology is. Simple. It's really simple. 3 minutes, you can turn a mask into a cell phone charger.
And it's completely automated.
Yeah, it can be completely automated. And it has an AI camera in the front. It knows what type of mask you're putting in, is sorting by color. So, you know, in a way, this is the most direct education, is to show and tell in front of people.
Show the possibilities.
Yeah.
Are there other tricks to invite like people who are young and who didn't know a thing about upcycling or about this vision of zero emission into saying, wow, I want to devote my life into that?
Oh, yeah, certainly. Every time we show the machine, especially the younger generations, they're always like, what do I need to learn right now to be able to do what you guys are doing?
I see.
And I think that's the ultimate compliment for us and our work, and really humbles us when you see your work can actually create this young generation of grassroots movement. And I'm going to complain a little bit on the younger generation grassroots movement. They talk about sustainability, but they don't put their action.
Yeah, all of them talk about sustainability now.
Yeah, but what action do they do? How can fast fashion be making money still? If you stop buying, if you know how damaging fast fashion is, how come they're still making money? That means the young generation is still buying.
I see.
So I'm sometimes I get a little, so, you know, like if you want to have a grassroots movement, especially for the young generation, don't talk about education. You have to actually put that into action already. And your daily consumption is already your action.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's not just about something you do intentionally. It's also stop doing things unintentionally.
Yes. So, I mean, like 7-Eleven. I know like a lot of people for construction person like me, I go to a construction site. It's really hot.
Mm-hmm.
You want to go to 7-Eleven or a convenience store and pick up a cold drink that's made from plastic bottle and then you feel great, okay? But for younger generation, they don't have going to a construction site. They are buying this as a consumption pattern.
Mm-hmm.
That's when it's not forgivable.
I see.
So that's mean they don't have the consciousness to even ask the right questions. They just say, I want to be sustainable. Yeah, these big companies, bad. Mm-hmm. Oh, that politician's bad. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's not green. Oh, we all all this stuff.
Yeah
but hey, your action is not helping. Yeah, so, and I really hope the younger generation will have a grassroots movement and really point the finger at the right people with action.
Okay. Yeah, actually, case in point, during the break, you noted that this is imported. Maybe it's zero waste eventually, but it's not zero emission.
Yes. It is, by the way, these glass are waste too, because...
So in the Taiwanese system?
Yes.
This just go to waste?
Yes. Yeah, this goes to waste. There's no real, systematic... recycling of glass, and even if you recycle them, glass transformation requires the same amount of carbon footprint. That savings.
That's right. So if you turn it into, one of the arts from trenchant body and so on, still it's going to cause emissions.
Yeah, the reason is because glass by default is a very high temperature item. So it still needs 1300 degrees. It still needs 800 degrees, 4 hours of curing.
Mm-hmm.
So that energy footprint is still just as much as you taking a boli sha, glass as a grinded glass.
Right.
So technically, there's not much saving.
Uh-huh. So while we may say, oh, it's upcycle and so on, what it does is that it converts that into emissions and heat and so on.
Yes. So that's why we mean by you want to also reduce the emission during the transformation process. Mm-hmm. So for example, what are you saving with metal and metal and let's say plastic.
Yeah, plastic.
Uh-huh. Metal and plastic. Uh-huh. Because you have to go out there into the mountains and dig out a mountain and take out that metal.
That's right.
You also have to take out that oil.
Yeah, if it's rare earth, you have to go very deep.
So that is where the real emission happens. And so if you can save that part of an emission, you keep this here. So of course, naturally you save around 60% already by default.
Well, from next recording on, we'll switch to a different format of drinking water.
Yeah. But once you open it, every time we go to a different meeting, if someone opened a bottle, I would definitely finish it.
Sure.
If you don't finish it,
the damage is done, right?
And
might
that's
as well drink.
Then you have to, but in general, shipping water is... I'm sometimes going to a restaurant, they give you bottled water.
Yeah.
If it's from Italy, from France. You know, all this consumption pattern is what? It's actually really just about a cultural, it's a feeling.
I know.
Yeah, it's not really because this water tastes better.
No, it's just a ritual of sorts.
Yes. Uh-huh. So that's why maybe you're talking about social innovations.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
I think this is a social innovation. I hope in Taiwan we can do a lot more.
Yeah.
And I see great sign about that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Taiwan now, Taipei City is banned single-use plastic.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I was so proud. I was so proud. I would go out to different places. Mm-hmm. I was like, always tell people Taiwan, you go to the night market, you go to all the government-owned building.
Mm-hmm.
I have to take a glass cup. I have to put my ID card there just to...
Even for... bubble tea.
Yes. I was just, this is super huge steps, huge. And I don't think anyone has done that yet.
Yeah, it's started from a petition by a 17-year-old young lady on our digital democracy platform.
Yeah, so thank you for actually creating that social platform for people. Then that is the voice turns into an action and forcing the government to enact. And by the way, if you ask every single one of a person who's serving the coffee, they all hate this system.
Ah, okay.
And I say, do you like this? Do you think single use is better or not? You know what they say?
What
they say they hate it.
I see.
I have to wash more cups.
Uh-huh.
They say my workload doubles.
Uh-huh. I'm sure there's something that could be helped by technologies.
Yes, or helped by technologies, or I think this is what they mean by ESG, right?
I know.
So how do you create this social enterprise where they are incentivized to do more of that without them feeling bad?
And with a real positive cash flow.
Yes, and so, for example, like, is there a, like, blockchain way? Is there a digital token way allows you to take your good behavior and actually convert that into another type of currency?
Yeah, convert that kind of family, encouraging each other, the Taiwanese spirit you was just talking about, and turning into something that also scales in a decentralized way. I do believe that's the future.
Yeah, give tips digitally. Right?
Exactly. Reward communal behavior in a way that does not give up control to a single state with social credit, right?
Yes.
So yeah, that's
totally
the idea.
Yes.
Yeah. So we probably have many future innovators, young and old, listening to us right now. So what issues do you think that our next generation of social innovators, young and old, can help tackle right now?
No, to me, there's only one.
Yes, I noticed the theme.
Yeah, there's only one. It's called a sustainable society.
Yeah.
A sustainable society, the Earth do not need us to be sustainable at all. Mm-hmm. The Earth is much older than us, much more powerful than us.
They'll still be there when we're gone.
Yes, they will still be there when we're gone. We're not here to protect some panda or turtles. Mm-hmm. No.
Polybius.
No. We are protecting ourselves, our way of life, our culture. So I think this is the most important part. You got to don't look at sustainable. So this only, if it's your own survival, that's the only thing you should care about. Everything else. So it doesn't matter what technology or what cultural, or if you're a writer, English teachers, doesn't matter what trade of life you're interested in. But you should all focus on the more equitable, sustainable society. You know? And then sustainable society require technology to act equitably and to actually be able to have zero waste, for example. That's what we're focusing on. But doesn't matter what format you're in, you should do the same.
Yeah, it's a goal that we can all agree on.
We must agree on.
We must agree on. Otherwise, we don't survive.
Yes, otherwise, we just don't survive. So this is an existential crisis moment. And I see the most immediate one beyond circularities, beyond sustainability. It's not the environment, actually. The climate change is just going to cause more social inequity.
That's right.
So how do you do this quickly, do this balancing act? So I actually agree with the government, even though I hate it, that I was just complaining that, you know, Taiwan government can no longer dish out financial support or government support for big companies. Why? Because now they can only disperse the many of financial support or physical infrastructure support.
Yeah.
Because it's all about not trying to make the big company richer, right? It's you can no longer do that, right? It's past the era, right? But how can you do that in a much more fair way, accessible way? I think that's the question that we should be all. And I see us. A funny thing is, I see us as part of that social innovation because we are always about empowering. We are creating a kitchen. We're creating a cookbook. We're encouraging community chef to cook more. You know, so this is my logic of our company logic of trying to engage with more young creators in a different field. So we want to be able to do this, to provide this community kitchens for the community creators to create more innovations. And so then there will be an ecosystem. Otherwise, the Social Balancing Act is not going to happen quick enough.
I see. Well, thank you for sharing this very deep wisdom and your action too.
I don't know about deep,
about making real change happen and the real truth about not just saying that we intentionally do circularity or things like that, but actually the math behind that, the real truth behind words like circular economy and sustainability and so on. So to me, I believe I'll be even more intentional in the future about not just the waste, but also the emissions. And I believe that we have seen new routes of innovation from your case and MINIWIZ's case. I think a crucial lesson, if I may summarize it a little bit, is just to get people curious and to understand the full picture, the full story behind everything, really. Yeah. And so thank you again for sharing your deep, I think, to me, wisdom. And thank you for appearing on Taiwan Plus.
Thank you, Audrey, for inviting. And thank you, audience, for listening to this rant.
it's real trash talk.
Yeah,
in
real
style
trash
and
yeah.
substance.
Yes, yes, yes.
So thank you for joining today. And please check more information on TaiwanPlus.com. We have a YouTube channel and click subscribe if you like today's episode. See you next time. Live long and prosper.
Well, yes. Yeah, never met Audrey before, only saw him on TV and always agree on many of his I know it sounds weird, but I always agree on many of his insights, on many of her perspectives. Yeah, so obviously we're in the more on the same generation, so sorry.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. No, it's very lively and relaxing. Get to talk about lots of stuff I never talk about. I think Audrey is very engaging in terms of its understanding of this equitable, decentralized way of social balancing or social innovation. I never thought we can define what we do on the social innovation level, but now, like, you know, once I can see where that's going, which is great. It's a new way of talking about, thinking about sustainability in the new light. No, but just decentralization, but in general about social equity. At the end, it's about decentralization. You have to pass down the value into the community, as simple as that. And you need to do that before. You cannot get to the right price or the right resources because you can only do so in a centralized, globalized economy. But now, with technology, you can. With smart machines, with decentralized many software systems, you can do it. So that's why I think it's very interesting that there's a group of technologists on the conceptual level, all the way to the government level, all the way to the mechanical, very physical level. There is that flow or a community of innovators, so which is very promising. No, I don't know TaiwanPlus. Yeah. Just kidding. Hope that we have more Taiwan external communication, and that's exactly your mandate, into an international format where everyone can understand better.
Yes.
And that bridge is exactly what TaiwanPlus is representing. Hi, I'm Arthur Huang. See you on TaiwanPlus.